But it's really great that he is a mental health chaplain. And I know because of firsthand experience over the years when I would call Ian, whether he still lived in BC or was out in Ottawa, and he was a real confidant and became a counselor of sorts, as friends can do, because he was very wise and helped me, was a big part of my transition moving from the evangelical faith, wrestling with my sexuality. And if you come from a strong conservative background, you know how hard it takes years to, it took me forever. I didn't get married until I was in my 40s. And Ian came out late as well. And he married Darren, his husband, who is here with us. And so great to have Darren here. They're staying with us, and we've had a great time catching up. And they live in Victoria right now. But Darren and Ian got married in 2015, is that right? And I'm not going to go on anymore except to say that, Ian, it is wonderful to have you here with us. It's great to have good friends that are, you when you journey and you find that there's like-mindedness that comes together even in your spiritual evolution. So Beth and Ian are going to come up now and have a conversation. I'm just going to get your little stools out, two to hang out with, as Friendly Giant might say. And so Beth has number two, Ian has number three, and can you hear back there, choir? Excellent, good. All right, over to you two. And,
thanks for that. I asked Lonnie to introduce you. I was hoping he'd tell some more stories, but maybe you can do that yourself. Yeah. You know, I thought about this day and how I wanted to share our history. It just also really seemed important this year to give some voice to what's happening in the military today and people who give their lives to this service, because it's different than it was 100 years ago. And so I'm thrilled that you're with us. And we'd just really invite you to start by sharing some of your story. I understand, and it's been alluded to, that there's been some life changes, some transformations since you've joined. Share with us. Who are you?
I need to start by saying how absolutely wonderful it is to be here, and thank you so much. I've known about you as a congregation back since when Lonnie and Hannes were beginning here. I've been here a number of times incognito for some concerts and services, so it's wonderful. And as Lonnie said, there's it's kind of interesting in answering that, because really I could look at Lonnie and my experience in our life, and the journey we've been on is so parallel and so matched. I'm a bit of a late bloomer. Lonnie was much faster. He always was just faster. Sorry, that's some of the dirt. I'll let you read into that as you wish, but unintended. In order to really understand my experience, it's what Lonnie alluded to. I grew up third generation Baptist, like Big B Baptist, so don't hold that against me, but my parents were Baptist missionaries, so I grew a lot of my life growing up in India, and I came back to Canada, I went to Trinity Western. I got ordained in the Baptist church. I served in multiple Baptist capacities, chaplain, pastoral ministry, counseling some, I married a good Baptist girl, and we had three Baptist children. So by the time I joined the military, I was well entrenched as a Baptist chaplain. The transition really began in around 2010, when our marriage kind of imploded, fell apart. Within the military context, it was on one level supportive, but she was also a chaplain, so it became very convoluted and problematic and political and painful. So I ended up in Ottawa kind of on my own, probably more suicidal than I often like to admit, but really in a lot of pain. And I went to a social worker, military social worker, and for the first time in my life, I was able to actually articulate and work through the battles I'd always had in terms of my sexual orientation, and obviously, as Lonnie said, growing up within the conservative, evangelical Baptist roots, that just wasn't an option for my life. And so through that process, I was able to come to a full acceptance of myself. And then I met Darren, and literally my life transformed because I realized this wasn't just some guy I met, you know, online. It was, this guy is, he's my soulmate, he's my partner, he's my partner in life. And he's standing over there. I'm going to make him stand up because he's going to hate me for that. And but this is Darren. Darren is a French immersion teacher in Victoria. And we got married in 2015. And needless to say, something hit the fan. And it wasn't particularly pleasant. I went through a process where I had to transfer my ordination credentials or risk losing my job, actually. So it was very painful. I went through a lot of basically having my Baptist heritage collectively turn their back on me and tell me I was no longer welcome, disown me, and yet I found my place with Darren, but also within the military context.
Well, it's interesting. I mean, people will say to me sometimes, like last night when I was out dancing, well, this is different. We don't usually see you in this context. And when you say you ended up in Ottawa more suicidal than you'd like to admit, I think you're really empowering people to see, oh, we have leaders in our midst who know real struggles. So when people think of a military chaplain, I'm sure all sorts of things come to mind, but maybe not what you've just shared. So I'm interested in how your life has then intersected and, in fact, informed the work that you're doing. I've never heard of a mental health chaplain. I would have assumed that military chaplains are burying people and running worship services. So tell us about your work and how your life has informed it.
Yeah, so I when I first did join, when all chaplains begin and we begin kind of this transition out of our kind of collective understanding of ministry, especially pastoral ministry, chaplains join as ordained clergy by and large, and often then have to go through this move where you have to fit within the military. You have to receive your basic officer training. You have to work within the military culture, the command structure, and so there's a lot of change there, but there's also tremendous opportunities. So after about 8 years, I was able to, through the military postgraduate program, was able to do a master's degree in counseling and psychotherapy through St. Paul University in Ottawa, and that then qualified me as a specialist, so a mental health chaplain. So I work within a clinical team of medical and mental health professionals, so the doctors, nurses, kind of within the military structure, but also a clinical team of mental health professionals, social workers, psychologists, psychiatrists. I tend to be a one of. There's only one mental health chaplain, and they still don't know really what to do with us, which is kind of fun because I get to do whatever I want and then say, well, that's just part of my job. So that's what I do.
And the stories you've heard over the years, I'm not asking you to tell other people's stories, but I am. Has your own journey enabled you to show up a little more empathetically? Do you find that, what are the stories that that our military service people are experiencing these days? Is it about post-traumatic stress from being in wars, in stressful overseas situations? Or are you helping too, just as much with everyday life?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Because, I mean, obviously everyone knows about the post-traumatic stress from combat missions largely Afghanistan. I work in a naval context, and I'm forever telling people, don't forget the Navy. The Navy has their own mental health issues within a naval context, and they're not people who are exposed to combat directly, but I'm definitely seeing a lot of mental health issues, largely because, they're military members. So you've got to understand, in order to understand mental health within the military, you have to understand that these are members of the Canadian Forces who basically agree as part of their job to go where they're sent, to deploy when they're told to deploy, and it usually the cost for them is not only their own, but also within family systems that are disrupted through that, and then obviously through their own, some of the mental health issues, stress-related and otherwise. And so really within the scope of my own practice at the clinic, a lot of it has to do with to receiving the member in whatever situation. Often it will be, relational distress, but a lot of it will be depression and anxiety that are related to their military service, PTSD, but we have within the mental health community in the Canadian Forces a term, the operational stress injury, which is has more to do with kind of a wider umbrella term for the mental illness, mental health issues related to operational service. And within chaplain specific, one of the areas that we've really been starting to target is an area called moral injury, which I think you would be particularly interested in because it really has to do with exposure to traumatic events or participating in traumatic events that completely jar and leave you, that go against your own moral sense of right or wrong, or and so you have a lot of people who have been exposed, and this is where within the Navy, you people who have been exposed to human trafficking or experiences of extreme prejudice, where they have had to go in, witness this, and not be able to do anything to protect or prevent or be involved in engagement that really goes in against their own view. So, no shortage of work. I'll tell you.
Indeed. Yeah. You as you have heard today, we lifted up stories of some Indigenous veterans, and I'm reminded that back in World War I, so Indigenous folks signed up and then came back to Canada and didn't even have the right to vote until 1960. Being part of an institution that, like all institutions, has a reputation of being slow to change. We might think that about the military. I'm wondering if you have inside information, or are there changes, at least in the chaplaincy area, around how do you chaplain in a multi-faith situation, and particularly with Indigenous peoples who are working?
Well, one of the advantages of actually being in the Canadian Forces as opposed to a clerical or church situation is the fact that it really is built around a command structure. And we have, I would say the Canadian Armed Forces reflects the values and of Canadian society. And so we uphold the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, and we place the value on on inclusion and diversity. I would say a big change happened a number of years ago when we were dealing with the issue of sexually inappropriate conduct within the Canadian Armed Forces, and I remember clearly as CDS at the time, the Chief of Defence Staff, which is the highest ranked military general in the Canadian Armed Forces, it stops now, is what he said, and began this program called Operation Honour, which then directly changed the climate of respect within the workplace, and basically saying there is a culture of sexualized culture within the Canadian military that needs to change But beyond that, we've also had a strong stress on diversity, on inclusion, on in particular Indigenous people, but also any visible minority. There's also inclusion of women within the Canadian Armed Forces, and recognition of sexual minorities, and the basic standard is, if you have an issue with it, you shouldn't be here. Really, it's just, I love it. It's absolutely, it's provided me protections to have a same-sex marriage that my church, my denomination, would not allow me to remain. But within the Canadian Forces, they said, no, you're protected under our diversity policy. So they can't really touch you. So a wonderful way. In terms of specifically Indigenous people, we have within the chaplain branch an Indigenous advisor, so Warrant Officer Moogly, can't remember his last name, anyways, he is the advisor to the Chaplain General on Indigenous issues, and really has been absolutely instrumental in terms of raising awareness of Indigenous inclusion within the chaplain military context. And so we are moving forward in a way that I'm not experienced so much in my church background.
Interesting. So. Yeah. All right, this question wasn't on the list, but one more question. Because you are a Baptist, right? So in this context, I might say, where have you seen the Holy Spirit at work? But I'm wondering, where do you see Jesus in your day-to-day work in this vocation of yours? And I didn't give you a heads up about that question,
I would say that for me, you know, and it also has to do with probably the thing we're wrestling here about, you know, how can you engage in, within the military when you are actively, one of your moral values is peace and peacemaking. And I would say probably the thing, I often get the question, you know, you really have had such a rough go with chaplaincy, why don't you just become a social worker? And I think a lot of it is because I feel like there is something symbolic and incredibly meaningful. Padres still have a role within the Canadian Armed Forces, a role of being peacemakers. We're non-combatants, which means when we go into combat, chaplains are forbidden by the Geneva Convention to bear arms. So we basically go in as a symbol of peace into the dogfights, into the direct conflict. So there's a symbolic representation that I may kind of downplay religion a lot, especially within my clinical practice, but I can never get over the fact that for most of my patients, my clients, I'm the priest that sits and listens to them, that accepts them, that places value on their life and hears their struggles and doesn't condemn them and doesn't tell them that, you know, they need to repent or that they need to clean themselves up. I'm able to, and so in a very Christ-like way, there is that acceptance that every day I feel like. Kind of Jesus challenges me, can you accept me in this image? Can you love this person even though they're struggling so much? And so that would be my answer. And
well, we're grateful for your service and for sharing with us today. I wonder if in our congregation today, I could be so bold as to ask those of you who have served in active service in the reservists to just stand and we can just acknowledge your service to Canada.
Thank you, Bethany. how can I encapsulate it? But I pressed on, and this came out of, I've been inspired whilst being part of this congregation. I've loved the wrestling, commemorating those who've served, and also struggling with how are we peacemakers in the world around us. And I find that our theology and what we have here can really hold that, and I've really appreciated that. And so out of a longing to be a peacemaker came this song, Peace Come Reign in Me. Now I ask you to join us in singing. Please stand as you are able.
Worship with all of you. If you are staying for the open house and the concert, and we hope you are, you're most welcome to join the Reconciliation Seekers for lots of free lunch in the fireside room and a viewing of the film Forgotten Warriors. Larry Arkell, a military historian and a representative